Now we are discussing the postcranial fossa here. It is the deepest of the three fossa and lodges the hindbrain, consisting of cerebellum, pons and medulla oblongata. You can see these are the limits of the postcranial fossa. Deepest and posteriormost cranial fossa lodging what? Hindbrain. The parts of the hindbrain: cerebellum, pons and medulla oblongata. And you can see here it is bound by the on either side by the superior border of petrous temporal bone, and in the midline by the basilar part of the occipital bone, and posterior infraangle of the parietal bone, squamous part of the occipital bone here. So these are the bones forming posterior cranial fossa. So what are the bones you see here? You can see the part of the posterior surface of dorsum sellae, that is sphenoid bone, occipital basilar part, petrous part of temporal bone, here parietal bone, posterior infraangle of the parietal bone, and the squamous part of the occipital bone, and you will see foramina magnum, the largest foramina of the skull, transmitting spinal cord, its vessels and other osseoligamentous structures. This is foramina magnum. So once you see this posterior cranial fossa, it is the deepest fossa, and in life it is roofed by the tentorium cerebelli, the layer of dura mater, that is tentorium cerebelli, and it divides the cranial cavity into supratentorial part and infratentorial parts. The supratentorial parts occupies occipital lobe, infratentorial part occupies the cerebellar hemispheres. Posteriorly, anteriorly, you will see pons and medulla oblongata. You can see there, that is the attachment there, tentorium cerebelli, superior border of petrous temporal bone and transverse sulcus, above occipital lobe, below cerebellum, and in front of cerebellum, that is occipital lobe, cerebellum, and here the brainstem, that is pons and medulla. Below it will continue as spinal cord, the brainstem will continue as a spinal cord, as you know here. So this is the posterior cranial fossa, deepest one, and divided into compartments by tentorium cerebelli. You can see the attachment, the upper border of petrous temporal bone and lips of transverse sulci on the inner surface of the occipital bone. And you can see this is how the tentorium cerebelli is there. You have already seen the attachments in the anterior cranial fossa also, in the middle cranial fossa also. Then you can see here, this is the compartment above and below. Above occipital lobe, below cerebellum, behind pons and medulla oblongata, in front. You can see. Coming to the floor of the posterior cranial fossa, it presents a large oval shaped central opening that is called as foramina magnum, and this is clivus. In front of foramina magnum, a sloping surface of the bone is called as clivus. It ascends to dorsum sellae. Clivus means hill, a small hill like elevation in front of foramina magnum, and formed by the fusion of base occiput and base sphenoid, or body of sphenoid here. You can see that is base sphenoid and this is base occiput. They are held by this primary cartilaginous joint or synchondrosis, which fuses into bone later. And this clivus is related to this basilar artery formed by fusion of right and left vertebral artery, basilar artery and basilar venous plexus. It is unpaired dural venous sinus, and also pons and medulla. So here the basilar part will give attachment to membrana tectoria, cruciate ligament and apical ligament. You should remember that three structures: membrana tectoria, cruciate ligament and apical ligament, from above downwards, and basilar artery, basilar venous plexus, pons and medulla related here. And behind the foramina magnum, the inner surface of the occipital bone presents a median ridge, that is there. that is, you can see there, superior pectoral sinus and inferior pectoral sinus, and behind the foramen magnum, here the inner surface of the occipital bone presents a median ridge that is called as the internal occipital crest, which extends above to form internal occipital protuberance, that is internal occipital crest, that is this internal occipital protuberance, and this internal occipital crest gives attachment to fox cerebelli and separates the or intervenes between two lobes or two cerebellar hemispheres, and this internal occipital crest diverge below into a triangular depression. It will diverge below there into a triangular depression that is called as vermian fossa, lodging the inferior vermis of cerebellum, and a transverse sulcus extends laterally on either side from the internal occipital protuberance, lodging, that is transverse sulci on either side of the internal occipital protuberance, lodging the transverse sinus and also giving attachment to the posterior margins of tentorium cerebelli, and traced further laterally, these are transverse sinus, and traced further laterally, it will continue as sigmoid sinus. These are, you can see sigmoid sinus into that sigmoid sulcus, what you see there, postero inferior angle of parietal and master part of temporal bone, what you see there, that sigmoid sulcus, that is there, that is sigmoid sulcus, you can see, which involves the inner surface of the parietal bone and master part of temporal bone and jugular process of the occipital bone, and it lodges sigmoid sinus, which will continue as internal jugular vein. It will come out via jugular foramina, and the sigmoid sinus is very important because it is related to mastoid antrum. In case of middle ear surgeries, you should be very careful while drilling the temporal bone or while going through mastoid antrum, you should be very careful. Sometimes sigmoid sinus may be superficial, and as you know, the features of sigmoid sinus is sinus doesn't have muscular coat, so they don't collapse. Bleeding will be there. Bleeding is difficult to stop. You can see that is mastoid part, you can see, related to sigmoid sinus. So ear surgeons should be very careful here. So you can see, and sigmoid sinus communicates outside via two emissary veins. Mastoid canal will be there. And you can see this internal occipital protuberance is a meeting place of occipital sinus, right and left transverse sinus, superior serratal sinus, and straight sinus. Five sinuses meet here: occipital, right and left transverse, superior serratal sinus, straight sinus. So five sinuses meet. It is called as confluence of venous sinuses. It is discovered by Herophilus, ancient father of anatomy, also called as Torcula Herophili. And you know, supraserratal sinus will continue as right, straight will continue as left sinus. And as you see on either side of the foramen magnum, you will see a hypoglossal canal in the anterior wall. Anterior part of the lateral margin of foramen magnum, you will see that is hypoglossal canal transmitting the hypoglossal nerve, and just above that you will see jugular tubercle, that is hypoglossal nerve passing through hypoglossal canal along with some emissary veins, also called as an anterior condylar canal, and above that you can see that is tuberculum jugular or jugular tubercle is an elevation above the hypoglossal canal and project into the posteromedial boundary of jugular foramen, and it is crossed by the glossopharyngeal vagus and accessory nerves from before backwards. That is jugular foramen, what you are seeing. So jugular foramen is again divided into three parts. It transmits inferior petrosal sinus in the anterior part, in the middle part 9, 10, 11 nerves, in the posterior part internal jugular vein. So posteriorly internal jugular vein, anteriorly inferior petrosal sinus, in the middle 9, 10, 11 nerves. You can see that. And the posterior surface of the petrous temporal bone, you can see, which is a part of the posterior canal fossa, is triangular, and its three borders are accompanied by three venous sinuses, superior, inferior and posterior. Along superior border you will see superior petrosal sinus, along the inferior border you will see inferior petrosal sinus, along the posterior border you will see sigmoid sinus. Sigmoid sinus will enter jugular foramina and continue as internal jugular vein. You can see superior petrosal sinus, inferior petrosal, sigmoid sinus, which will continue as internal jugular vein bypassing through jugular foramen. You can see there. And posterior surface shows this internal acoustic meatus. It is a bony canal about 1 centimeter long, lies in line with the external acoustic meatus. It transmits the facial and vestibular cochlear nerves and labyrinthine artery. Remember, this is internal acoustic meatus transmitting 7th and 8th nerves along with labyrinthine artery. Labyrinthine artery is a branch of basilar artery. Basilar artery is related to clivus here. And you can see the lateral end of the internal meatus. These are the structures passing 7th and 8th nerve. And which artery? Labyrinthine artery. The lateral end of the, what you can see here, the lateral end of internal meatus is closed by a bony plate, which is subdivided into horizontal crest into upper and lower parts. Upper part again divided into two parts, anterior and posterior. Anterior is related to facial nerve, posterior to the superior vestibular area, that is upper division of vestibular nerve. The lower tract is for the tractus paralis and cochlear nerve, inferior vestibular nerve, and sometimes it presents a foramina singulaire behind and below the inferior vestibular area. And then you will see a subarcuate fossa, indistinct, or you can say not so prominent depression behind and lateral to internal acoustic meatus. It lodges the process of dura mater and transmits some blood vessels, and the subarcuate fossa is prominent in newborn. And behind the internal acoustic meatus, there lies an oblique slit. If you can see here, this is the internal acoustic meatus. And behind this internal acoustic meatus, there is an oblique slit. Now you can see. Now this is the oblique slit. Yeah, that is the oblique slit related to the aqueduct of the vestibule. It lodges saccus and ductus endolymphaticus. That is the aqueduct of vestibule. You can see there, and just above the anterior end of jugular foramen, and that you will see a pyramidal notch. It lodges the inferior ganglion of glossopharyngeal nerve, and here from the apex of the pyramid a tiny cochlear canal lodges the aqueduct of cochlea. That is aqueduct of cochlea and all, aqueduct of vestibule. So these are related to the posterior part of the petrous temporal bone. Remember this. And this pyramidal notch, PN, is related to inferior ganglion of glossopharyngeal nerve. So this is about the posterior canal fossa. Hope it is helpful. Please comment and like and share and provide your honest feedback. Thank you.